Harper Audio presents Driving Miss Norma, One Family's Journey Saying Yes to Living by Tim Bauerschmidt and Ramie Liddle, performed by Christopher Grove and Nan McNamara. Prologue. Home. Baja, California, Mexico. February. Tim. For nomads like us, home is a relative term, and ours is far off the grid, on a slip of beach that separates jagged volcanic rock from the azure waters of the Sea of Cortez in Baja, California, Mexico. Each winter, on this special slice of planet Earth, we unhitch our 19-foot Airstream trailer and temporarily come to rest. One beautiful late February morning, we hit the water early. Ringo, our 73-pound standard poodle, sat perched at the front of my wife Ramie's paddleboard as dolphins teased him to jump off. The mist from their blowholes was backlit by the dawning sun, filling the air with a rhythm that took my breath away. I could taste the salt water on my lips from their exhalations. Ospreys and blue-footed boobies dove for their breakfasts, while a whale shark filtered plankton as it passed below our boards. The sun finally revealed itself over the mountains, turning the Bay of Concepcion a bright, glassy gold. Later, as we bobbed in the water with some fellow beach dwellers, also taking a break from paddling, our muscles and spirits loosened and the conversation turned philosophical. The topic of aging came up, particularly the aging of our parents. We all hypothesized what we would do and how we would handle it, making plans, imagining some future way, way off. What would Ramie and I do if her mother, Jan, in western Pennsylvania, or my parents, Leo and Norma, in northern Michigan, could no longer care for themselves? When was it time to intercede on our parents' behalf and how? What kind of care facility was appropriate? What were their medical directives, their hopes, their fears? Ramie's mother, so social and an avid bridge player, would probably thrive in an assisted living situation. But my parents, who practically lived outdoors in their garden and whose lives were so predictable and so entrenched, would suffer in such a place. In general, open roads and aging parents do not mix, which is why I had always assumed my younger sister, Stacy, would be the one who cared for them in the end. But Stacy, my only sibling, had died of cancer 8 years before.
"Well," Ramie said, "we don't need to figure it all out. Not today. We have time. Everyone is still healthy. For now, let's just enjoy the moment."
I put my fears and questions aside in favor of enjoying the moment, trusting that I had that time, hoping that I had that time. We had not always lived on the road, although I think in one way or another, this simpler, unattached lifestyle always called out to us. When Ramie and I first met, we figured out that we collectively had lived in 14 different states. It was just synchronicity, we said, that we had wandered into the same place at the same time on the day we met. I was a self-taught builder, driving an old Ford pickup truck around the country and remodeling homes. Ramie was a non-profit consultant and had previously worked on cruise ships and at resorts in order to support her wanderlust. We had both lost close family members at an early age. Having experienced our share of grief, we were conscious of wanting to live in search of meaning rather than a paycheck. We yearned for a life lived off the beaten path, free from material things, financial burden, and even family demands. Our lives changed forever the day Ramie's sister, Sandy, called from Maryland to offer us an old Airstream travel trailer. We were nearly 2,000 miles away in Colorado and did not own a tow vehicle, but we were definitely interested. With a borrowed Chevy pickup, we drove east to see our prize.
I was 45 years old, and both Ramie and I were getting tired of tent camping and sleeping on the ground. The prospect of laying down our heads in the comfort of something with wheels was a dream come true. The trailer was old, but it had new upholstery, a small kitchen, and a functioning toilet. I ran my hand along its weather-beaten aluminum exterior, hot from sitting out in the July sun. Its iconic curves stirred a sense of anticipation in me. "This is going to be great," I told Ramie. We used the drive back to Colorado as a shakedown cruise. Our biggest decision of each day was where to park and spend the night. We felt ourselves stretching and expanding into new freedoms. Upon our return, Ramie traded in her beloved convertible for a shiny red pickup truck with a tow package, and we were on our way to discovering a new lifestyle. We used the trailer every chance we got. It took only one bad winter as nomads to convince us to head for warmer climes during those dark months of short days and extended nights. We had been fixing up an old fisherman's cabin in northern Michigan near my parents' house that was only intended for summer use. No matter how much hardwood we stuffed into the rusty, time-worn stove, the cabin lost the heat in a matter of hours. There was no insulation in the walls or ceiling. At night, the two of us and our dog at the time, a German shepherd named Jack, shivered together in our communal bed. I found myself dreaming of the beautiful, sunny beach where I had tent camped a few times since the mid-1990s. It was then that we settled on Mexico's Baja California Peninsula as our winter destination. During our first season in the Baja, we educated ourselves about the off-the-grid recreational vehicle, RV, lifestyle. We relied on a small solar panel to keep our battery lively while also conserving power use. Amps and watts and other electrical terms suddenly had relevance in our lives, a lesson we learned the hard way when our lights flickered one night and we realized we were almost out of juice. Water conservation, too, became more important than ever, since fresh water had to be hauled in from a small fishing village half an hour to the north. There was no dump station for our wastewater, so we depended on the hand-dug latrines that dotted the beach. We took showers out of a solar bag in a makeshift outdoor stall we created with a hula hoop and a shower curtain balanced over an open truck door. Despite its lack of amenities, the Baja was a magnet for a multitude of personalities from around the world. Folks like Yella and Deb, sailors and folk singers from Canada. For them, home in the summer is a sailboat anchored in Maple Bay off Vancouver Island. Winters are spent on Baja California beaches in a 13-foot vintage travel trailer with no bathroom. Chris and Bessie, retired computer programmers who once lived in South Africa, now split time between upstate New York, San Francisco, and the Baja. There was Santa Wayne, British Columbia's best-loved Santa Claus impersonator. He did not arrive at the beach until after Christmas, for obvious reasons. And who could forget Pedro and Janet, the colorful international ringmaster for equestrian show jumping events and his Dutch-born horse trainer wife? Pedro did not leave his flamboyant style behind just because he was at the beach. These regulars, the ones who came back year after year, were mainly North Americans. But many other foreign travelers passed through on their way to mainland Mexico via the ferry in La Paz, located farther south. Our days always started with an early kayak paddle around the nearest island, located 1 mile offshore. We would float and wait for the sun to rise over the mountainous peninsula that formed the bay, rejoicing in the stillness of the morning before returning to shore. We would grab a quick breakfast of locally grown strawberries over yogurt before joining a group for a 3-mile walk up the hill and then down a windy desert trail back to the bay. After getting the local beach gossip on the way to our trailer, we would decide what else to do that day. Paddleboarding, swimming, a longer hike, or perhaps visiting friends, new and old.
everyone avoided talking about politics and religion, and eschewed news from the outside world, even if it was just for the 4 or 5 winter months each year. We connected with these like-minded beach dwellers. While both Ramie and I found it difficult to maintain friendships in the many towns and neighborhoods where we had lived, here it was different. Here, where there was no traffic, no news, no external clock to watch, people could go about the business of just being, with the earth, with one another, with themselves. We felt like we truly belonged. We spent 2 of the 3 winters we owned the lake cabin on our half-mile crescent of sand in the Baja. When we sold the cabin, we bought a larger airstream and spent the following winter in Florida, while Ramie earned a postgraduate degree in school counseling. We traveled to Colorado for her internship, and then parked in Prescott, Arizona, living in our trailer until we found a home there to renovate. While the larger trailer was more than adequate to live in, we wanted to travel, explore, and feel closer to the natural world. We found ourselves staying home more because it was too much of an effort to drag the behemoth around. Realizing the problem, Ramie and I decided to downsize to a 19-foot Airstream Bambi. This worked better for us, and we then traveled for months at a time, usually in the shoulder season, when school was in session and families generally stayed home. The national parks and other attractions were less crowded during these times. Our road trips, now with our new puppy Ringo along, grew longer and longer. Whole summers, 6 months, and even more. We were gone so much that our Arizona home was empty most of the time. When Ramie was working, we traveled during school breaks around the Southwest, exploring places like the North Rim of the Grand Canyon, Death Valley, and Bryce Canyon, and Zion National Parks. In the summers, we visited friends in Tennessee and North Carolina, and dropped in on Sandy, the one who started it all, in southern Maryland. Northern Michigan was always a stop whenever we went back east. In 2011, during a year-long sabbatical, we spanned the country from coast to coast and north to south. We left Arizona and traveled north through Nevada's Great Basin, on to Idaho's Sawtooth Mountains, and then Glacier National Park in Montana. From there, we traveled west and followed the Oregon coast south, continuing along California's coastal Highway 1 until we reached the Mexican border. After wintering in the Baja, we spent spring and summer traveling east across the southern tier of states and then north all the way to Maine before turning back toward Arizona. We loved to nestle our little Bambi between the boulders of Utah's Arches National Park and hike early in the morning before the crowds and heat arrived, or park in a secluded grove of redwood trees in Northern California and sleep under the 1,000-year-old canopy and even older stars. We made friends at familiar stops and headed for places where our Baja California friends lived. In Avery, California, we stayed on John and Lori's land, high in the Sierra Nevada, parked on a flat spot in the canyon that follows Love Creek. One year, we arrived during apple harvest season, so we rolled up our sleeves and helped process more than 200 pounds of apples the old-fashioned way, with a heavy cast-iron grinder and a slatted hardwood press, before filtering and then funneling the sweet juice into bottles. One Easter, we had returned to Arizona, and because we had rented out our Prescott home, we had parked on our friend Casey's 38-acre horse ranch in Williamson Valley. Early that Sunday morning, Casey strolled up to our Airstream and asked for our help with something. Much to our surprise, our time there coincided with breeding season for her magnificent stallion Morgan, and before we knew it, we were helping assemble, operate, and regulate the temperature of a brand new artificial equine vagina. We worked on being more flexible, and we became more forgiving of ourselves and of others on the road. We did not have much choice, really.
orchestrating our travel plans around free dump stations, which our GPS sometimes failed to locate, and travel delays in small towns, whether due to a parade, a marathon, or road construction, sort of demanded an open mind and a free spirit.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.